Welcome to Beyond the Blockchain with Scott Tindall, a discussion of blockchain technology, cryptocurrency, and why it matters to you.
Hey folks, welcome to Beyond the Blockchain. I'm your host, Scott Tindall, here with you on 106.5 FM Talk, as we are every Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. So we appreciate you joining us and listening in on what will be a little bit of a different show today. We're going to talk blockchain technology as we always do, but we're also going to talk this new concept called the Vault that we're going to introduce, and hopefully the Vault will help give us inspiration on how to generate a little more extra income, whether that's to pay your bills and fight inflation or if that's to invest in cryptocurrency. But it is something that we've kind of teased before on the show and something we'll be able to talk about in further detail later on. We normally start the show off with some headlines going on. I think the biggest headline right now that I keep seeing over and over is Elon Musk buying Twitter. And a lot of people might say, why does this matter to a show like Beyond the Blockchain? And the answer is that Twitter is one of the main hubs of communication for cryptocurrency companies and platforms. And it's the way that a lot of people in the crypto industry or just crypto interested communicate with one another. And so Elon Musk has stated that his goal is to get rid of the bots, which if any of you are on Twitter and have ever talked about cryptocurrency before, you know that's the one of the first way to get the bots on top of you in a hurry. You'll end up with, you know, 30 messages in your inbox trying to sell you whatever garbage, you know, some computer bot is trying to sell you. So Elon cleaning up Twitter, I think, can have a really positive impact on the blockchain ecosystem and the cryptocurrency space. What we're also going to see with Elon is it looks like now that he is the sole owner of Twitter. So just to give you a little update, if you're not familiar with this story, Twitter was previously publicly traded. And Elon Musk, the world's richest man, spent $44 billion with a B to buy Twitter. Now, his idea here is that Twitter is the town square of the digital era. It's the town square of today. And that it should be there and it should have a space for people to have free speech and to be able to express disagreement with one another without extreme censorship. And that's something that we talk a lot about in the blockchain space as well, is owning your own data and controlling censorship or lack thereof, not being controlled by censorship. So with Elon taking over Twitter, we should see more crypto news there. We should see more crypto influence. I don't think it's going to go away. We've also seen recently that Elon Musk has been contentiously arguing with or debating with people on Twitter about using the product and maybe what he might charge for verification and validation. So if you're on Twitter, you know there's this idea of the blue check mark, and that is verification that you are who you are. And that's important. But it shouldn't just be reserved for the elite or for those who have large followings. So Elon's proposal is that for the low, low price of just $8 a month, you can be validated, verified, and have your blue check mark. Now, we've seen some pushback from people like Stephen King, who say absolutely not. He would never pay for this blue check mark, even though he's got millions of followers who he's able to interact with on Elon's now private messaging system. There's pushback. I think that's going to fade away pretty fast. I think people get, especially these verified accounts, are getting far more value than $8 a month out of being able to communicate with their fans, their supporters, their customers, whatever it is. All this threat of people leaving Twitter because of Elon, I think, is going to be much about nothing. I don't think that's going to stick. We have seen that, you know, that price of $8 a month is likely to vary across the world, which I think is pretty important. You know, $8 to an American is not the same thing as $8 to someone in an emerging economy, especially some of these emerging economies where these reporters kind of need this validation because they're getting suppressed by their governments and arrested even for reporting things those governments don't want you to know about. So I think they'll become a compromise and they'll find a way to make it work. But at the end of the day, if you've got millions of followers, $8 is really a low price to pay. And Elon's just out there trolling people to death right now. If you're just looking for some good entertainment, that may be a good place to start. But it's interesting nonetheless, and it is going to have a big impact on the blockchain movement and blockchain technology and cryptocurrencies. What is going to come to, from that? I don't know yet. I don't think anyone does, but it will be interesting. All right, we're going to step away here and take a little break. And when we come back, we're going to jump right back into more crypto news. We're going to talk about how over 40% of people in both parties agree that crypto is the future of finance. That is a big number. When we come back.
Welcome back to Beyond the Blockchain with Scott Tindall.
Hey folks, welcome back to Beyond the Blockchain. I'm your host, Scott Tindall, here on 106.5 FM Talk. If you're interested in calling in or texting in, we are taking questions today at 251-343-0106. So it's 251-343-0106 if you want to call or text in. At the bottom of the hour, we're going to have Tate Richards join us, and we're going to talk more about Footium, our Web3 football challenge that we're getting after, football being soccer in this case. But we've talked about it before. It is basically like creating Madden, but, a better version because you get to own all that you're building. So that's going to be pretty neat, and we'll talk about that. But what I want to talk about right now is this idea that Democrats and Republicans can actually agree on something, and that is rarely the case. But there's an article here that is from actually news from Bitcoin.com. And it says, Democrats and Republicans agree cryptocurrency is the future of finance. So you say, how in the world can they agree on that when they don't agree on anything? Well, here's the details. It says, a new survey has revealed that Democrats and Republicans agree cryptocurrency is the future of finance. The national survey was conducted by the Harris Poll on behalf of Grayscale Investments, the world's largest digital currency asset manager. So let's take that into account. This was on behalf of Grayscale. But in the survey, they found 44% of the respondents said they expect to have crypto as part of their investment portfolio in the future. Now, Grayscale, they're the largest digital currency manager, as we said. They announced on Tuesday that the new surveys revealed that Democrats and Republicans agree that crypto is the future of finance. That's the quote they use. Democrats and Republicans agree cryptocurrency is the future of finance. Now, it later goes on to say that the online survey was conducted between October 6th and 11th. So, just a couple weeks ago, and they polled 2,029 people who are all likely voters, so not a small number. I'd be interested to know in what parts of the country they took this poll from, but we don't get that data. The survey later goes on to tell us that how Americans view the state of the economy and cryptocurrency against the backdrop of the 22 United States election. So we got that coming up on Tuesday, right? If you listen to this station, you know all about that. But what it says is 53% of Americans agree that cryptocurrencies are the future in finance. That's 59% of Democrats and 52% of Republicans. Wow. I can't remember the last time I saw such alignment anywhere. But that's interesting. And maybe this is why. And the rest of the article says, with record high inflation and a looming recession, looming as though we're not currently in a recession already, which I think is certainly arguable. 25% of respondents say inflation and the current economic climate have made them more interested in cryptocurrency. So the CEO of Grayscale, Michael Sonnenhein, he commented and he said, as we approach the midterm election, U.S. voters are considering the intersection of cryptocurrency, traditional finance, and the state of the economy. Now, what's interesting to me is we've talked about blockchain technology in the future and the practicality of it, right? So every week we're talking about another project which has practical use cases. And I think people now are starting to become more aware of these practical use cases, and it's no longer just speculation, hype, or a bubble. We've also talked about regulation of the crypto industry And anyone who doesn't think it's coming is probably not paying attention. And the analogy that we've used on the show before is kind of like the FAA. So when the FAA was begun, I'm certain there was a lot of back and forth about the necessity of federally regulating aviation. I don't think there's much debate about that right now. I don't see anyone out there protesting saying that we should be removing towers and air traffic controllers from airports because it shouldn't be regulated. There's no one out there saying that the feds should not have control over our airspace. So we have to kind of think of it like that. This is more of how do we ensure we end up with appropriate regulation instead of overreaching and inappropriate regulation? And the answer is, I don't know the answer. And I don't think anyone is, but it's something that we should, it's just something that we really should think about. Now, let's get back into this article. It says, clear crypto regulation does have bipartisan support. So regarding crypto regulation, 39% see the U.S. as being behind other countries in creating a regulatory environment that makes it easy or safe for anyone to buy or trade digital assets. I would say that's pretty clear in America right now. It doesn't feel very safe to buy or sell these digital assets. You really need to know what you're doing. That's why we encourage people to start easy with a Coinbase wallet or something that's very mainstream, U.S.-based, publicly traded, because the rest of the crypto market is the wild, wild west still. So I think that's probably a fair statement. Now, furthermore, 81% agree that there should be clearer industry regulation, including 88% of Democrats and 77% of Republicans. So now we've got more than 4 in 5 of both Republicans and Democrats feel it's important to take a consumer-first approach to regulation. This is kind of what we were saying. And now the math is backing it up. So 81% agree we need more regulation. And of this, it's 81% Republicans and 82% Democrats that feel like we have to take a consumer-first approach to the regulation rather than a government-first approach. I don't know about you, but that is surprising to me. I really just didn't expect the numbers to be that high on either side. I kind of would have expected Republicans to be less in favor of regulation, but I'm equally surprised that Democrats favor a consumer-first approach to regulation. I don't know what that means going into the midterms. I don't know what that means for the next 2 years, but it is something that's going to be on the radar that people are going to continue to talk about, and it's going to be something that we're going to have to talk about on this show each week. Now, what does that mean when we say a consumer-first approach to regulation? Well, what it means is allowing consumers and not the government to decide how to invest in cryptocurrencies by providing the necessary information about the various products. There's also something called the Crypto Council for Innovation. I do not know who these people are. But in this group, it says they're a crypto advocacy group, and they recently conducted another study, and that found that a majority, 52%, thinks crypto needs more regulation than presently exists. I think that's a fair number. 52% thinking we need an FAA version for crypto seems like a reasonable number. 80%+ thinking that that approach should be consumer first. Pretty surprising, to be honest with you. I didn't expect it to jump up that high. But that is something that we're going to have to keep an eye on. It's something that I think is definitely not going away. And it's something that, even though it doesn't feel like it's affecting us every day, it's really going to matter because it's not just the cryptocurrencies themselves, it's the blockchain technology underneath. How are we going to, regulate these blockchains? If so, what is the transparency required? What are going to be the difference in public and private blockchains? And what are we going to do with our data? Because that's a big thing that we've talked about for quite a while, is what do we do with our data, and how much control do we have of that data? Now, another thing that we're going to talk about here today on the show is, like we said, we're going to talk about Futium and Web3, but there's a couple of different clubs that I want to talk about. There's really two here that we've decided to focus on. Now, Tate is he's hard at practice right now. We don't know if we're going to get him on the show tonight. But what I do know is that he's done a lot of research for us, and he's found two clubs that I think make sense for this kind of mantra of what we want in a Web3 football club. This is where the show should be fun, right? We talked a lot about regulation. Now we get to talk about fun. Once again, just to back you up, to let you know what Footium is. Footium is a Web3, meaning, you know, the future of the internet. We've talked about Web1 was read-only. Web2 was like what we have with social media, where we can discuss back and forth. And Web3 is this idea of we not only discuss back and forth, but we get to own and control our data. So we've talked about Footium, and essentially it's like a soccer version of Madden, like you might have played in college. Except now you can own your own team, and you can build your club, and if you do well, you can move up in the rankings, and you can also sell your club. So Tate has done a good job of identifying two clubs that I feel kind of makes sense for what we're doing. So when I was talking to Tate, I said, here's what I want to look at. This is the formula that we want to build our club after. It's something we call grit, right? Grit is traditionally the unique combination of passion and perseverance. And that is important. That's the overarching umbrella. But grit for us is also an acronym. And it stands for gratitude, relationships, innovation, and teamwork. And here's why that matters. Throughout all of our companies, and especially inside this crypto space, we think that you should start with the position of gratitude. If you aren't thankful for what you have, you may never appreciate what you get in the future, even if you don't get it. If you don't appreciate it now, it won't matter. The R is for relationships, because as much as possible, everything should be relational and not transactional. The I is for innovation, because creativity is thinking new things, but innovation is actually doing those new things. And the team is for teamwork, because we need a diversity of skills, experiences, and resources on our team, because if we were all just alike, we wouldn't need each other. So that was Tate's kind of mission statement to take it out there. And he's found us two clubs, one trading at about $600, the other trading at about $300, and they kind of fit this model. So we've got Berry Hill Villa Football Club, and they're the Berry Hill Villa FC, based in the region of Berry Hill. The financial region of Berry Hill is run down, right? This is something that makes sense for us. These folks are coming from an economy that's rough, and they still support their team, right? And we can go through the stats. But the important part is they're a group of folks that continue to support their team even when they're down on their luck, all right? The next one we have is Kimswood United. Now, Kimswood United also is a club that's seventh tier. Remember, we're trying to climb up. In international soccer, they have something called promotion and relegation. And the idea is, imagine if we took college football and we said, if you finish in the bottom two of the SEC this year, you're going to get demoted to the ACC. And the two best teams in the SEC, I mean in the ACC, get to move up to the SEC. That is what international football is like. So you're always fighting for promotion, and you're always trying to avoid relegation. If any of you have watched Ted Lasso on Apple TV, you'll see some talk about that, right? AFC Richmond is trying to avoid relegation. If you've watched Welcome to Wrexham, which is another great soccer show starring Ryan Reynolds and Rob McElhenney. Same idea. They've taken this club, Wrexham FC, this Welsh team that used to be in a top tier that's really fallen on hard times, and they're trying to rebuild them. And so it's kind of the same idea. We're going to take this Ted Lasso model, this Welcome to Wrexham model, and see if we can do the same thing with a Web3 football club. It's going to be weird. It's going to be interesting, but I think once we kind of get it settled, it's going to be a lot of fun. And that's really what Web3 is supposed to be about. It's supposed to be about fun, taking control of your data. If you're going to spend all this time, energy, and effort pouring it into something, wouldn't you like to know that you could own it and then keep it, maybe pass it down to your friends, family, maybe your children, or you just sell it whenever you're ready? That's the difference in what Web3 can do for us that Web 2 is not able to do. So once again, remember Web 1, the first version of the internet, we just consume information. Web 2, we can actually reply and we can respond and we can build a relationship and we can communicate with one another. And that's social media networks. Web 3 takes both of those and adds a new layer on top of it. Now we can have a new payment layer, which are the cryptocurrencies. And we also have this new layer of owning data and tracking it via the blockchain. And that's going to make the biggest difference. Now, by next week, I think we'll narrow it down and we'll know which of these two clubs we really want to get after. But that's kind of an overview on Futium, the clubs we're looking at, and ways we can have fun together while still participating in crypto and Web3. All right, when we come back from the break, I'm going to mix it up a little bit. I'm going to tell you about this concept called the vault and ways you might be able to help pay your bills.
Welcome back to Beyond the Blockchain with Scott Tindall.
Hey folks, welcome back to Beyond the Blockchain. I'm your host, Scott Tindall, live here every Wednesday night at 7 o'clock on FM Talk 106.5. If you're interested in calling in tonight, the number is 251-343-0106. We'd love to visit with you. The beginning half of the show, we talked some news about Elon buying Twitter and how that's going to affect the blockchain and cryptocurrency. We also talked about the fact that over 80% of both Democrats and Republicans think that we need consumer-focused and consumer-friendly regulation about crypto, which was a pretty surprising number to me. I'll tell you what else is some pretty surprising numbers to me is the rate of inflation and the fact that we just added another 75 basis points today to the interest rates. And that's going to have a profound effect on a lot of people. And it's going to have a profound effect on the way you go about life. Well, one of the things that we've knocked around here on Beyond the Blockchain is this idea of creating something called the Vault. And the Vault is this place where we can all share together to learn new information to help us out here, whether that's make a little extra money to pay your bills, to fight inflation, or to invest in the crypto projects that we talk about on this show or any others that you're interested in. People always ask me, like, well, how do I get a little extra few dollars to start investing in crypto projects? Because, you know, I don't want to dip into my normal money of how I want to pay my bills. And so we tried to think through this a little bit, and we came up with this concept. It's called the Vault. The idea behind the Vault started by thinking, what do you have around your house that may be far more valuable than you even realize? And through this, we've come up with quite a list. And I'll go through some of them. And if you're interested in following along on Twitter also, there's a guy named The Collectibles Guru, and he talks a lot about this stuff as well. So interesting Twitter out there. We're talking about Twitter again. Interesting place to have a lot of these conversations. But if you're looking to pick up a few dollars now and you want to invest them in crypto or elsewhere, here's a little bit of a way to get started. So the first one is to look around your house for old Apple products. And that can be used iPhones, iPods, iPads. You know, even if your screen is broke or maybe you bought a new one and put the other one to the side, some of these broken ones still bring good money. And the ones that are not broken are still selling for hundreds of dollars. And if, this is always fun in each of these categories, if you happen to have a first generation iPhone that's still in the box, it could be worth over $30,000. Can you believe that? iPhone came out in 2009. Here we are, 14 years later. If you happen to have one in the box, worth $30,000. Now, here's the second one. Hot Wheels. Really? Hot Wheels? Yes, Hot Wheels. Old, rare Hot Wheels still sell for thousands of dollars. Now, a lot of the ones that I probably had as a kid in the 80s, they may not be worth as much, but some of the old ones really are. And what you're looking for is you're looking for cars with a red line through the tires and any other particularly old ones. Now, if you want to know how much this stuff is worth, remember, eBay is a really good place to find out. But when you go on eBay, don't look at the listed prices. You want to go to the sold items. when you go to the sold items, you can see what these items have sold for, either the highest ever, or you can search by sold recently. Now, here's something that I know our coin guys talk about, right? Down there at the Loop. They talk about coins, and everybody has loose change around our house, right? Worst case scenario, it's worth the price of the coin. But the best case scenario is you could have some really rare coins worth a ton of money. And there's places you can go out there to look up the values of these coins, or you can talk to Angelo and the guys down here in town, and they can help you as well. But don't assume that your old coins are only worth a quarter, is not always worth a quarter, is what we talk about. And a dollar is not always worth a dollar. In fact, when you're looking at dollar bills, any of the paper money that you have, one of the things to do is look at the serial number. There's some serial numbers that are worth far more than others. And one of the best ones is what's called a birthday serial number. So theoretically, my birthday is 9/15/1981. That also works out to the exact number of numbers on a dollar bill. So if you have somebody's birthday, look at your dollars in your pocket. If you have somebody's birthday, that's worth far more to them than it is to you. And you can sell it for far more than the face value. So I always encourage people, look at the serial numbers on your paper money. Why not? Can't hurt anything. All right, next up. People are pretty familiar with this, sports cards, right? I think a lot of folks collected sports cards when they were kids. The good news is if you grew up in the 80s and 90s, you probably got a ton of cards of your favorite players, and it was fun to collect. The bad news is they're probably not worth much. We call this the junk wax era. And these cards were mass produced, but they're still beautiful. They're still really cool, and people collect them. What you also want to do is look for any rookie cards you have, or just kind of Hall of Famers. But what really helps is maybe you've got a collection that's just been sitting around in the family. In fact, when my dad passed, he was born in 1951, and he handed me these cards that were from 1961, when he was 10 years old. Now, not a lot of them are still in great shape, but they still have value, and they're worth more to other people who are trying to collect specific cards. So keep an eye on that. Also, Pokemon cards. I know a lot of you probably bought Pokemon cards for your kids and you thought, what a waste of money. Surprisingly, some of these Pokemon cards are worth a tremendous amount of money. If you have those around your house, pull them out. If your kids have gone off to college, go find those cards that you bought back in the 90s, because some of them are worth a substantial amount of money and they're just sitting around your house. Now, this is one of my favorites because it's just kind of what I'm into as well, is books. First edition books of legendary titles can be worth tremendous amount, thousands of dollars, all right? A lot of people have these first edition books around their house and they don't even realize it. So what I typically look for is it a book that was turned into a movie? There is something that's got major value. Did you buy Jurassic Park when it first came out in 91, 92? Whatever it was, you probably have a first edition. That first edition Jurassic Park is probably worth at least $100, and it's sitting on your bookshelf. If you have any of the John Grisham books when they first came out, the ones that became hit movies, if you have first editions of those, also worth hundreds of dollars. And these things are just sitting around your house. But I'll tell you what else you can do, and I've done this before, is stop by a thrift shop and just look at the titles on the shelf. And if you see something that is very familiar, pull the title, open it up, and on the publisher's page, it will show you what edition the book is. And in fact, you might be able to go to a thrift shop and pay $3 for a book like Michael Crichton's The Firm, John Grisham's The Firm, which are then worth a substantial amount of money, maybe hundreds of dollars. You're looking for guys like Michael Crichton, John Grisham, J.K. Rowling, the Harry Potter books, Stephen King. I know a lot of you are Stephen King collectors. We talked about him a little bit with Twitter as well. But you know what? If you've got those around the house, you need to pull them out and you need to check on them because they could be worth a ton. Next up, old toys. You probably bought old toys for your kids. Y'all remember Tamagotchis, Furbies, Polly Pockets? Any of these can be worth hundreds of dollars. What's also worth a lot of money, especially if they're in great condition, Super Soakers. People love to collect Super Soakers. And did you know Super Soaker was invented by Mobile's own Lonnie Johnson, the Williamson alum? So if you want to know what those are worth, go to eBay again. Check out the sold listings. Now, here's the one that's a little different. China. Turn your China upside down. Look at the artist or the manufacturer, and you may have something special there. Another one people don't expect, Legos. Old Lego sets. They're worth more than you think. Even loose bricks, right? Clean them up. They're still worth something. Just put them in a big Ziploc bag. Go on eBay, and you'll be shocked at how much these things are worth. Now, we all know vinyl records. Everybody knows records have value. But specifically, you're looking for some that may be unique. And there's some pretty cool apps out there. In fact, my friend Johnny Gwynn has put me on one before. And what this app does, and I'm going to find it for you real quick, but it allows you to go in and scan the back of your album and know exactly what that album is selling for anywhere around the world at any given time. That's pretty cool. And finally, video games. People don't expect this, but did you know that if you still have like old Nintendo games still in the boxes, these things can be worth hundreds of dollars. And if you have one still sealed up, thousands of dollars. I mean, I know that's wild, but this is true. And don't forget comic books and rock and roll posters. But the thing I want to throw out here the most is my dad had a 1950-something Mickey Mantle, right? He put it in his tires of his bicycle because that's what kids did. They took their favorite players. They put them in the bicycle spokes. But if you didn't, let's say you held on to a 1952 Mickey Mantle, the next one that comes up for sale, if it's what we call a PSA 10, meaning it's the highest quality, it's going to sell for about $100 million. So dust off those cardboard boxes, see what you have there. And once you do, if you've got some interesting stuff, reach out to us. Reach out to me on Twitter, Facebook. I'll help you figure out what these things are worth, because the more you're able to figure out now, the better off you'll be. You can decide if you want to keep it, sell it, maybe trade it to somebody. Consider us like your own version of Antiques Roadshow. All right. When we come back from the break, we're going to wrap it up. We'll talk a little more about the vault and just some more crypto news. Thanks for sticking around with us. Talk soon.
Welcome back to Beyond the Blockchain with Scott Tindall.
Hey, folks. Welcome back to Beyond the Blockchain. I'm your host, Scott Tindall, and I appreciate you joining us here on 106.5 FM Talk. If you missed the beginning of the show, you can always go back and catch us on the website or wherever you get your favorite podcast. Also on YouTube. We upload the show to YouTube every night, and so it'll be there tomorrow. Now, to wrap it up, what I want to talk about is one of my favorite times of the year, and that's the World Series. I'm a baseball fan, love baseball, grew up with it. It was poured into me as a child. I remember my parents, mostly my mom, watching Braves games, even when the Braves were terrible. But it does give me the opportunity to talk about another crypto story, and that's Topps. Topps, the Major League Baseball trading card company, also a collectible company, they now have released NFTs as part of the World Series. So we've talked about NFTs before. Remember, it's this non-fungible token. It's basically a digital collectible. And while during the bull run and the crazy market we had a couple years ago where money was just flooding into the economy, NFTs rose to record highs. Then they came crashing down. But irregardless of that, there is a place for NFTs in the future of collectibles, and especially when you're trying to identify specific things that you need to be able to track. So here's what Topps is saying. So Topps has introduced a number of NFT collections over the past couple of years, but now they've got one coming up for just the World Series, and they're calling it Topps Now MLB Postseason. Now, according to them, this collection curates the top 12 Topps Now moments from around postseason, and it'll be released in three drops. The first drop was called the Wild Card Division Series Set. That happened on October 25th. Yesterday, we had another drop. They called it the Championship Series. And following that, we've got one coming up on November 10th. And this is the World Series Set. So if you're a Phillies fan, If you're an Astros fan, you're probably keyed in on the World Series set. I know these Philly fans are just going crazy this season. After only winning, I think, 87 games during the regular season, they've just really turned it on. And Bryce Harper is having one of the best postseasons of any player we've ever seen in Major League Baseball. I'm certain he's going to make the World Series set NFTs, and I'm certain that these are going to be worth a substantial amount of money at some point. Now, the idea here is to, as explained by Topps Digital, the vice president of Topps Digital, Toby Lent, says, through each round of the playoffs, fans can look forward to collecting the unforgettable moments that make postseason baseball so special with newspaper and broadcast-style imagery exclusive to the digital collection. Now, if you collected cards before, remember, the only way you would ever get some World Series collection would be next spring when the next year's set of Topps happen to come out. Now, with this project called Topps Now, Topps not only can print a digital copy almost immediately, you know, a couple days after, but what they're also able to do is offer you NFTs in real time. So this says the Topps Now MLB postseason packs of NFTs are going to be $35 a pack, and they come with 5 cards per pack, right? Remember, we're not talking about physical cards. This is digital NFT. Topps notes that there are 2,750 packs available, with 73.64% of the cards being common and 26.18% being rare. Now, they also have a minuscule 0.18% of the digital cards that are considered legendary items. So I think it's safe to say that when people are buying these Topps Now NFT packs, they're probably gambling and they're probably hunting. Most of the industry now is a whole lot of hunting. But if you're just a fan of baseball, it may be something that you want to collect. It's the first ever, as far as I know, postseason Major League Baseball NFTs. If any of them were ever going to have value, seems like the first release would be one that does. Now, Topps also says that each pack of this postseason card is guaranteed to provide at least one rare card. So, at least for your $35, you know you're going to get a rare, at least one, which is 26% of the cards. Now, the article goes on to say that Topps is releasing this NFT collection at a time when NFT sales have dropped considerably during the last year. Floor values have shed enormous value during the last 12 months, and as far as the Topps NFT collection is concerned, the company says the gold legendary design will highlight 3 key milestone moments from the 22 regular season. Now, the gold legendary design will offer fans the rare opportunity to collect Aaron Judge's 61st and 62nd home runs, as well as Albert Pujols' 700th home run. Topps explained this on Friday, stating the NFT collection will drop from Topps featuring MLB postseason athletes and taking place during the 118th World Series, which is going on right now. So, if you're a baseball fan or if you're a collectible fan, it's probably something that you might want to pay attention to. I'm not here to tell you that $35 is a good or bad price for that. I don't honestly know because we just haven't seen enough of these and they haven't been around long enough. I'll be very surprised if they turn into $100 million like the 52 Mantle did. But then again, in 52, no one thought a Mantle was worth more than probably putting it in your bicycle spokes or trading it with your friends. So that's just part of what we don't always know. We don't understand necessarily what the value will or will not be. Just know that when you're buying an NFT, you are buying a product that is unique, trackable on the blockchain, and you know exactly how many they are. One of the biggest problems that we have, I think, with normal collectibles is not knowing how many exist. We talked about the junk wax era of 80s and 90s cards. Millions of cards were produced, and we just didn't know how many there were. But here, we know specifically Topps is giving us the answers. 2,750 packs available, 73.64% are common. But what does common mean? Common Bryce Harper, still going to be a great, great asset coming out of this set. Bryce Harper is going to be in the Hall of Fame. There's no doubt about it. Jose Altuve, Hall of Famer. Verlander, Hall of Famer. To get your hands on Hall of Fame NFTs the very first time might be worth it to you if that's something that you're really interested in and you care about. As for me, I think I'm going to pick one up when they come out on the 10th. And I hope that I'm one of the 2,750 people that get a chance. In fact, I think they're probably going to sell out just from Phillies fans. I just can't imagine that the Phillies fans aren't going to gobble all these up, especially as they're 2-1 in the series and looking really strong. And I think they're probably going to close it out in six, if not, you know, in five. But we'll see later tonight as here we are live radio. We're in the middle of the third inning. Is 0-0 Astros Phillies. Now, you want to keep up with what's going on in NFTs and the world of collectibles, follow me on Twitter as well. We talk about NFTs. I talk about collectibles. I talk about things I'm interested in, which also includes a whole lot of crypto and just interesting, fun stuff. So if you want to join along on the fun, me, Johnny, Sean Sullivan, a lot of our friends, Twitter is the place to be. And who knows, maybe we'll all be paying Elon $8 pretty soon to get our own blue checks. So if you've had questions, concerns, comments, you know, you can always bring them to us. I love visiting with other people. I had a great lunch today at the Junior Achievement Luncheon. Thanks to my friend Dan Brennan for inviting me. And if you don't know what Junior Achievement is, boy, this is really something you're going to be interested in after learning more about it. It's all about entrepreneurship, free enterprise, and teaching students K through 12 the value of these business principles that we talk about on the show all the time. So check out Junior Achievement. Thanks again to my friend Dan Brennan for introducing me to it. You can catch him and Dalton in the morning on right here on FM Talk 106.5. And we'll see you soon. Thanks for joining us, and I'll see you next week.